A big thank you to Surfshark for sponsoring today's video.
It's time to talk about the future, the far future. Often we already discussed SpaceX's Starship, how it will enable humanity to become a multi-planetary species, as Elon Musk likes to say. But what will happen after that? What will be the next goals after we have established cities on the Moon and on Mars?
Well, for Gwynne Shotwell, the COO of SpaceX, it's pretty clear, namely that in our lifetimes there will be a technology breakthrough that will enable interstellar travel. But where should we go and how would such an interstellar starship even look? Well, I would say, let's try to find out.
In April and May 2019, the 64-meter-wide Parkes Radio Telescope, located in Australia, was pointing its large dish towards a small red dwarf star called Proxima Centauri. Over the course of a few hours, a signal was observed while the radio antenna was pointing towards the direction of Proxima Centauri, and it was not detected at all when the dish was pointing towards another direction. So why are we telling you about this? And what does this have to do with an interstellar starship? Well, because the star Proxima Centauri we were speaking of is the nearest star to our solar system at a distance of only 4.24 light years. And the signal that might have possibly emanated from there just made the Proxima Centauri system a lot more interesting.
Currently, we know about two planets circling Proxima Centauri. The first is Proxima b, a rocky planet slightly more massive than Earth with 1.17 Earth masses, nicely situated in the habitable zone of the parent star. This means there could be water on Proxima b, and with luck even some form of life. Of course, this depends highly on the strength of Proxima b's magnetic field, since Proxima Centauri is a flare star, regularly emitting strong bursts of highly energetic particles. But hopefully the James Webb Space Telescope will help us to find out soon if Proxima Centauri b hosts some form of life. Another planet is Proxima c, which is about 7 times more massive than Earth, but which is a lot further away from Proxima Centauri, so that it's either a mini Neptune or a frozen rocky super-Earth. Not far away from the Proxima Centauri system, 4.37 light years away from Earth, are two other stars, Alpha Centauri A and B, a double star system. In fact, it could even be that it's a triple star system and that Proxima Centauri is gravitationally bound to Alpha Centauri A and B.
To this day, unfortunately, we still haven't confirmed the existence of planets around Alpha Centauri A and B. But we are pretty sure it's only a matter of time until we will. In the movie Avatar, an Earth-like planet with some funny blue people living on it is circling a Jupiter-like gas giant called Polyphemus in the Alpha Centauri system. So if we build an interstellar starship to our nearest star systems, it will certainly either be the Proxima or the Alpha Centauri system. The signal which might have originated from Proxima Centauri, if it is confirmed, might actually increase the probability of the first interstellar starship being sent to that destination. But how would such an interstellar starship even work? Well, it will certainly work very differently from our current starships.
When Starship starts from Earth on its way to Mars, it will have a speed of about 32 kilometers per second relative to the Sun. At that speed, our good old Starship would need a relaxed 39,759 years for the journey. Why? Well, because it turns out that one light year is a pretty insane distance. It's the distance that light travels in 1 year, and as we know, light is pretty damn fast, with a speed of around 300,000 kilometers per second. So a light year is about 9.461 trillion kilometers. Therefore, Proxima Centauri is a whopping 40 trillion kilometers away from Earth. We know that velocity is speed over time, thus the time is 40 trillion kilometers divided by 32 kilometers per second, which is 1.254 trillion seconds, which turns out to be the aforementioned 39,751 years. Now we are all for relaxed traveling, but this is a bit too relaxed for our taste. Even the fastest probe ever built, namely the Parker Solar Probe, which at its fastest sun flyby in 2024 will have an impressive speed of 192.19 kilometers per second, would need a still too relaxed 6,618 and a half years for the voyage to Proxima Centauri.
It therefore becomes brutally apparent that with current chemical propulsion technology, we will not be able to reach even our nearest star systems. So what can we do? Well, turns out, there might be some solutions. But before we get into those solutions, we want to introduce today's sponsor to you. If you have been watching us for a while now, you'll know that we are not afraid to speak openly against censorship. And today's sponsor, Surfshark VPN, bypasses any censorship and geo-blocking.
Just like us, you probably have already gone through all your favorite series and movies on your local streaming service, but have you ever considered that the Netflix or Amazon Prime Video from another country will open up a whole new world to you?
You can just switch your location in the VPN setting, like super easily, and now you have access to a brand new library of content, which had been locked from you previously. So if you are a Stargate SG-1 fan like us, the series is not available on the European Netflix. So thanks to Surfshark, you can watch Stargate SG-1 even outside of the US, no matter where you are. TIAC would really approve.
It will not only give you a whopping 83% off the regular subscription fee, but also 3 extra months of service totally for free. And Surfshark even offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself.
Thanks, Surfshark! Claim your right of a free and safe internet now by simply clicking the link in the description below.
So, back to the interstellar starship. What form of propulsion would such an interstellar starship even employ? In order to qualify for interstellar travel distances, our criterion will be to reach at least 5%, but better yet, 10% the speed of light, in order to be able to reach the Proxima or Alpha Centauri system in less than 100 years. 1. Dusty plasma-based fission fragment nuclear reactor ship. The researchers Rodney A. Clark and Robert B. Sheldon proposed an innovative nuclear propulsion system using dusty radioactive material plasma as a fuel source. In short, a dusty cloud of radioactive nanoparticles is being contained in a magnetic field where radio frequency induction coils heat the plasma up to very high temperatures. High energy fission fragments are then focused into a narrow beam which leaves the fission engine with up to 5% the speed of light. Such an engine would have a specific impulse of 1 million seconds or about 2,600 times that of a Raptor engine. The specific impulse is a measure for how efficiently a rocket or spacecraft uses up its fuel for acceleration. But there is a small problem with this fission engine, namely that a trip to Alpha Centauri in under 100 years would require a 208 gigawatt reactor, as the authors write, and would consume 240 metric tons of fission fuel. Not feasible.
2. Nuclear pulse ship. The principle here is brutally simple, but brutally effective. Such a starship would employ a nuclear or a hydrogen bomb explosions in order to accelerate itself. The ship would throw out bombs in regular intervals, which when they detonate, create a strong thrust against a pusher plate, which would then absorb the shock and turn it into acceleration. This process would be repeated many times until starship would reach speeds of a few percent the speed of light, and then the ship would decelerate the same way. This concept was already developed back in the 50s and codenamed Project Orion. However, this concept has many problems, from the very large amount of nuclear bombs required, to the capacity of the shock absorbers to transfer the momentum from the explosions smoothly to the vehicle, to the problem of heat dissipation with the very high temperatures the pusher plate would have to endure. So in our opinion, this is not a very feasible solution. 3. Nuclear fusion starship. In contrast to nuclear fission, in nuclear fusion, light elements such as deuterium, tritium, 3 helium, 11 beryllium, or 7 lithium would be used by fusing together and releasing almost 0.3% to 0.9% of the mass of the nuclear fuel as energy. So this process is multiple times more energy efficient than nuclear fission. Therefore, the exhaust velocities are accordingly also higher, namely up to around 10% the speed of light. Project Daedalus, a study conducted between 1973 and 1978 by the British Interplanetary Society, proposed a design for an uncrewed interstellar probe employing such a fusion drive, which would in theory be able to reach 12% the speed of light. This would allow us to reach the Alpha or Proxima Centauri system in under 40 years.
There is just one problem though, namely that we currently do not have any fusion reactors yet that produce more energy than we put in. And also we would need an aneutronic fusion reactor. This is a reactor where no neutrons are produced as reaction products. Neutrons extract too much kinetic energy, thus reducing the attainable speeds to only 4% the speed of light. So 3 helium, 6 lithium, 11 boron or similar reactors would be needed. 3 helium might be advantageous because it can be harvested in large enough quantities from lunar regolith. So if technology progresses further, this could be a feasible solution.
4. Light Sail Starship. Breakthrough Starshot aims to send an uncrewed interstellar probe to Alpha Centauri by accelerating a light sail to 15%, even up to 20% the speed of light. The light sail is being accelerated by a multi-kilometer large phased array of high-power lasers with a combined coherent power output of up to 100 gigawatts. This, of course, could be scaled to much larger sails of a diameter of 100 kilometers. For such larger ships, speeds of up to 10% the speed of light would still be attainable, and it could even decelerate when nearing the target star system by having a magnetic sail. The ship would interact with the plasma of the target star's solar wind and with the interstellar medium, thus decelerating the ship. So the light sail concept could turn out to be a very feasible solution to an interstellar starship. 5. Far future propulsion concepts. Of course, there are more outlandish concepts, such as matter-antimatter drives. This would allow for ultra-efficient mass-to-energy conversion rate of up to 40%. No, not 100%, since a lot of the energy would be lost as high-energy gamma radiation and as neutrinos. But still, this could allow us to reach speeds of higher than 50% the speed of light. The EM drive seems to be not working. What a surprise. So we can put that one to the files. Then we of course also have the black hole drive, which is a really awesome concept. The Romulans from Star Trek, for example, use black hole drives for their Warbird class ships. Come on, one Star Trek reference has to be. Then we also have the famous Alcubierre warp drive and even more outlandish stuff, such as wormholes.
Both these concepts could possibly enable faster than light travel in the very distant future, if they would actually turn out to work. But they all come with problems of their own. We probably will examine all these drives in own episodes because they deserve to be dealt with in a lot more detail than would be possible in this episode here. So, to sum it up, a starship to our nearest neighbor, Proxima Centauri, would quite likely employ a large solar sail or aneutronic-based fusion drives. And what we might possibly discover over in the Proxima system, well, that is something left for the imagination. But we are sure it will be extremely exciting. Don't expect an interstellar starship though before the year 2100, best case. Now we talked about the propulsion, but how exactly would such a starship then actually look? Well, we'll talk about that in part 2.
And we'd like to thank our team who helps us a lot with the videos, especially over on the Discord server.
That is MLLT, Stefan van der Feest, Zabolcs Jare, who additionally also helps us with the subtitles, Warhawk and Space Boris.
And we'd also like to thank the other admins on our server, Another Space Nut, Framebreak, Miko, and Rich LV.
And a big thanks to our newly established fact-checking team, you guys are great, namely MLLT, Space Boris, Stefan van der Feest, Zabolcs Jare, and Miko. Thanks guys.
And lastly, we of course want to thank Jay Keegan and Michael Root for constantly updating our website, jstothefuture.com.
So then thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future. So then, thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future! Nein, das war nicht cool genug. Now we can see customized stuff if you want, but
no,
you don't have to.